Once again, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to historic Joint Base Myer-Henderson Hall and today's Armed Forces farewell tribute honoring Barack Obama, the 44th President of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the arrival of the official party and remain standing as honors are rendered. Taking their positions on the reviewing stand are the Honorable Ashton B. Carter, Secretary of Defense, accompanied by the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph F. Dunford. Ladies and gentlemen, the Vice President of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The troops representing America's armed forces and participating in today's review from left to right are the United States Army Old Guard Fife and Drum Corps, the United States Army Band under the direction of Colonel Timothy J. Holton. Elements of the armed forces include the Presidential Marching Platoon from the Army's 3rd United States Infantry Regiment, the Old Guard, the United States Marine Honor Guard from Marine Barracks 8th and I, Washington, D.C., the colors have always been one of the most important elements of a military unit. At the center of our formation is an Armed Forces Color Guard, bearing the national colors and the service flags of the Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, and Coast Guard. The following is an element from the United States Navy Honor Guard from Navy Yard, Washington, D.C. The next element online is comprised of members from the United States Air Force Honor Guard from Joint Base Anacostia, Bowling. Following is an element of the United States Coast Guard Honor Guard from Coast Guard Station, Alexandria. And to the rear of the formation are the 56 state and territorial flags of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the advancing of the colors and remain standing for the United States National Anthem. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The Department of Defense Medal for Distinguished Public Service is presented to President Barack Obama. President Barack Obama distinguished himself as the Commander-in-Chief of the finest fighting force the world has ever known, from January 20, 2009 to January 20, 2017. President Obama kept our nation safe, led a strategic transition in our defense strategy, strengthened our alliances, and pursued new partnerships, and laid the foundation for a force of the future that will continue to win our nation's wars. President Obama countered decisively the most immediate threat to our national security, terrorism. He directed the operation to kill Osama bin Laden, decimated Al-Qaeda's terrorist network, put the Islamic State of Iraq and Levant on a path to a lasting defeat, and developed counterterrorism platforms from South Asia to North Africa. He did so relentlessly, effectively, with increased transparency, and in strict accordance with our values. Simultaneously, President Obama achieved verifiable nuclear disarmament of Iran, the gravest threat to security in the Middle East. And while countering proliferation abroad, he directed recapitalization of our vitally important nuclear deterrent here at home. As he successfully neutralized immediate threats to our security, President Obama also directed a transition in our defense strategy. He implemented a rigorous intellectual, policy, and legal framework to guide the most solemn decision that a commander-in-chief makes, to deploy and employ our men and women in uniform. He supported strategic investments to perpetuate our military edge in the air, at sea, with missile defenses, and in space and cyber domains, including by establishing the United States Cyber Command. In so doing, he led the transformation of the United States military from over a decade of counterinsurgency into a full-spectrum fighting force. And critically, he directed the United States' rebalance to the Asia-Pacific, the most consequential region for America's future. President Obama also recognized that security in the world cannot be America's responsibility alone. He strengthened our alliances and pursued new partnerships. In Europe, he led the adaptation of NATO to continue its commitment to a stable Afghanistan and to actively counter threats to Europe's east and south. In particular, President Obama directed the bolstering of our allied military presence in Europe and reestablishing of deterrence against Russian aggression. In Asia, he modernized our alliances with Japan and Korea, strengthening the cornerstone of security in East Asia and deterring threats from North Korea. In the Middle East, he strengthened Israel's qualitative military edge, including with an unprecedented package of foreign military funding. But in an ever-changing world, President Obama recognized that America's relationships must also change. He directed the advancement of new strategic partnerships, including the unprecedented deepening of the strategically consequential United States-India partnership. In all of this, President Obama recognized that the source of America's greatest strength, including its military strength, is its people. To ensure that the United States military stays the best, he understood that we must continue to attract, recruit, retain, develop, and transition the best talent that our nation has to offer. His repealing of the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy and his support for opening all military occupations and positions to women will help ensure that. He also championed advanced research and an innovative program to care for our nation's wounded warriors and their families, and led efforts to help veterans make the transition to civilian life. These and many other distinctive accomplishments of President Obama reflect great credit upon himself, the Department of Defense, and the United States of America. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the posting of the colors. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, General Dunford.
Mr. President, Vice President Biden, Secretary Carter, distinguished guests, thank you once again for joining us as we pay tribute to our Commander-in-Chief in the Obama family. Mr. President, I have the distinct honor today of representing your soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen. And as you know better than most, those men and women are busy. Thousands are deployed across the globe. They're meeting our alliance commitments and deterring potential adversaries. They're taking the fight to the Islamic State, Al-Qaeda, and other extremist organizations. They're maintaining freedom of navigation in the defending us from threats in space and in cyberspace. Throughout your time in office, we've often heard you express your appreciation for their service and their sacrifice. But this afternoon, Mr. President, I want to express our appreciation for your leadership and honor your service as our Commander-in-Chief for the past 8 years. Mr. President, we've been at war throughout your tenure. That's a period longer than any other American president. And throughout those years, you've always been there for us. You were there in a situation room where I personally witnessed your thoughtful and careful deliberations when ordering our young men and women in harm's way. You were there visiting the force wherever it was deployed, ensuring that our men and women had the guidance and support necessary to get the job done. You were there in the holidays meeting with troops and calling them around the world to simply say thanks. You were there when our wounded warriors returned home to heal. Your constant visits to Walter Reed were without fanfare or ceremony, but always marked with heartfelt words, hugs from moms, and more often than not, a few lunges and push-ups alongside those who were trying to recover. Finally, Mr. President, you were there at Dover Air Force Base to receive the remains of the fallen, and you were there to visit them at Arlington. I could go on, but let me share a few sentiments from the men and women that you have touched as a leader. Lieutenant Colonel Will Phillips sent this message. Mr. President and First Lady, thank you both for your tireless dedication to our nation. President Obama, you've set an example for us all as a statesman, a father, and a husband. Corporal David Dennis, who's currently deployed to Iraq, told me how much he appreciated your call on Christmas Day to say thanks for his sacrifice and service. Sergeant Major Troxell and I, by coincidence, met with him a few hours after your call, and he was still pretty pumped up after that call. I was a bit disappointed because after your phone call that morning, a visit from the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and his senior enlisted leader actually didn't carry much weight. Major Matt Lampert made the following comment about your hospital visit. When I met the president, I was just regaining the ability to walk. I had some days that were tough and some days of doubt. But shaking hands with President Obama and having a conversation with him was something that will stick with me forever. Given the responsibilities that he shoulders, President Obama's thoughtfulness and common touch were pretty inspiring. Master Sergeant Keith Norris described what your support for educational benefits as a senator and as a president has meant to his family. If it wasn't for the post 9/11 GI Bill, my wife and I could not have afforded to send our children to college. My oldest son just graduated, and I'm excited he's on track to be commissioned in the United States Air Force. Well, I wish he was going in the Army. You may have figured out that he's a Master Sergeant in the Army. Well, I wish he was going in the Army. I'm incredibly proud that he'll be the first military officer in my family's history. Chief Warrant Officer Nate Powell commented on the impact of your support to military spouses. Like most public school teachers, my wife doesn't earn all that much, but she loves being a teacher. Because of the Military Spouses Residency Relief Act that President Obama signed into law, my family saves thousands of dollars a year that would otherwise have to pay just because she has chosen to move with me across state lines from duty station to duty station. And on the lighter side, Captain Alex Lowe, who's an Air Force flight surgeon, is also apparently a big fan. He said, I'm glad to have started my service under such a charismatic and cool commander-in-chief who can also play ball and sing a mean Al Green. I can't witness that, Mr. President. I've not had the opportunity to see that in the Situation Room, but I'm going to take Captain Lowe's word for it. Mr. President, on behalf of Lieutenant Colonel Phillips, Corporal Dennis, Major Lampert, Master Sergeant Norris, Chief Warrant Officer Powell, Doc Lowe, and all of our men and women in uniform, we recognize and appreciate your service, your sacrifice, your commitment to the force, and your leadership. Of course, just as military families serve, so has the Obama family. While unable to join us this afternoon, Mrs. Obama and Mrs. Biden's creation of joining forces has made a lasting impact. It significantly expanded veteran job placement and educational opportunities. The First Lady's legal advice and tireless advocacy has also benefited military working spouses, making careers more transportable for spouses who move every few years. In fact, the entire Obama family has served, and it'd be impossible to sum up all their contributions this afternoon. So in closing, I'll simply say, Sasha and Malia, thanks for sharing your mom and dad with us and the nation. Mrs. Obama, thank you for improving the lives of our families and veterans, and thanks for representing our nation with such class. And Mr. President, thank you for being a commander-in-chief that we have been proud to follow. On a personal note, sir, thanks for your confidence in me and in all of the senior leaders who have had the privilege to serve on your watch. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to introduce another individual who's made a lasting impact on our joint force and someone we've been proud to follow, our Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ash Carter.
Thank you, Chairman Dunford, for that tribute to the President and the First Lady's commitment to our troops and our families. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Department of Defense leadership, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. As the Department honors our Commander-in-Chief of 8 critical years for one final time. This afternoon, I'd like to do so by speaking of those aspects of his service and commitment to our national defense that have been so striking and that will be so memorable, each one a constant throughout his tenure as our president. His focused strategic leadership, his steps to strengthen our force, both in its people and in its capabilities, and his decision-making. Through it all, President Obama has led our military with an appreciation that America's defense is so vital that we, to whom it is entrusted, must ensure its continuity and excellence across the years and across the domains of armed conflict, not just air, land, and sea, but also space and cyberspace, across parties, across government agencies, from strategic era to strategic era, and from presidential administration to presidential administration. And he's done so not only for the last 8 years, but even today, as we prepare for a new administration, we're following the president's leadership and ensuring a smooth and orderly transition. Our military is a global force, one that President Obama has steadfastly and strategically led in every region of the world to ensure the men and women of the strongest and most principled fighting force in history effectively defend our country, deter our adversaries, bolster our alliances and partnerships, and make a better world for our children. In the Asia Pacific, President Obama has sustained a comprehensive rebalance of military power to that region, the single most consequential one for America's future. There, we're repositioning 60% of our naval forces and overseas air assets, including some of our most advanced new systems. And we're strengthening and modernizing key alliances and partnerships with Japan, with South Korea, India, Vietnam, Australia, many others. In Europe, following Russia's illegal annexation of Crimea and use of hybrid warfare techniques, President Obama has stood strong with our NATO allies and led a united response to deter Russian aggression, enhancing U.S. force presence and implementing a new playbook so NATO can adapt against 21st century threats. In the Middle East, President Obama secured an accord that's verifiably preventing Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon, removing a key source of danger in the region. But as we continue to counter Iran's other destabilizing activities, he's also strengthened the defense relationships with all our key regional partners. For example, providing our ally Israel unprecedented security assistance and advanced capabilities across domains. And around the world, in the face of terrorist threats from Al-Qaeda to Al-Shabaab to ISIL, President Obama has led the most robust and sustained counterterrorism fight in American history. In the counter-ISIL campaign, the president consistently supported the development and acceleration of the coalition military campaign plan, focused on destroying the fact and the idea of an Islamic State based on this evil ideology in Iraq and Syria, countering the ISIL cancer's metastases everywhere they emerge, and most important, protecting our homeland and our people. In addition to countering ISIL, he's taken action to ensure Afghanistan does not become a safe haven for terrorists to threaten America. He's directed 8 years of unrelenting strikes on Al-Qaeda to devastate that terrorist organization, both before and after bringing Osama bin Laden to justice. He's built a counterterrorism apparatus that has thwarted countless plots against our homeland. And he did all of this, all of it, consistent with our values, because our president knows, as he's put it, that we lose ourselves when we compromise the very ideals we fight to defend. At the same time, President Obama made sure our military stayed strong and grew stronger in our people and our capabilities to meet those ambitious but necessary commitments. Indeed, our president knows very well that the single factor, above all others, that makes the U.S. military the finest is its people, some represented here today, far more around the world. President Obama has been dedicated to improving the quality of life of our force, making sure our service members get what they need, not only when it comes to training and equipment, but also important benefits critical to recruitment and retention, like maternity and paternity leave. He's helped keep sacred the commitment to wounded warriors, the families of the fallen, to military families, and to veterans. He's made sure our people are treated with the dignity and honor befitting the profession of arms, from supporting DOD's efforts to rid our ranks of sexual assault to improving our suicide prevention efforts. He's helped ensure the long-term viability of what is, after all, an all-volunteer force, recruited in comparatively small numbers from the entire American population, recognizing we have to compete for top talent, and that to have the best, we must select the best solely on their qualifications to meet our high standards, not race, gender, identity, or sexual orientation, rather focusing only on whether someone can meet our standards. And he's also supported veterans in their transition to whatever's next for them in life, whether it's earning a degree, finding a job, or starting a business. I know how much that matters because I'm old enough to remember a shameful time when our veterans were treated very differently. After our people, it's America's capabilities that make our military edge second to none. And President Obama has sharpened that as well. He always asks, are we looking around the corner? To ensure we not only anticipate the changing nature of warfare and future threats, but also stay ahead of them and take full advantage of new technology. Under his leadership, DOD began returning to full spectrum capability in the Army and Marine Corps after many years of skillful but all-absorbing focus on large contingent counterinsurgency deployments. We grew the size and the lethality of our Navy and drove forward the development and production of new fighters, bombers, and tankers for the Air Force. We increased funding for innovative technologies and R&D, notably in critical domains like space, cyber, and electronic warfare. All this amidst persistent budget turbulence and uncertainty. And even as President Obama has worked toward a world without nuclear weapons, he's also ensured the United States maintains a safe, secure, and effective nuclear deterrent for as long as these weapons exist. And finally, from the vantage of someone who's worked for 11 defense secretaries over 35 years under both Democratic and Republican presidents, and now being secretary myself, I want to offer some perspective on the nature and the quality of President Obama's leadership and decision-making as our commander-in-chief. Because it's often most appreciated by those who've had to sign deployment orders, who've been to Dover, to Bethesda, Walter Reed, who know that the decisions he makes have consequences. Most Americans don't get to see how President Obama makes decisions about our national security. So let me give you a window into what it's like when we meet in the Situation Room or the Oval Office. To begin with, he's steady, deliberate, rigorous, and demanding of himself and of us, always reflecting the seriousness with which he approaches the grave responsibilities of the presidency. He makes us think through the consequences of a proposed course of action as thoroughly as that can be foreseen. And he always focuses first and fixedly on our North Star, America's national interests. I've been grateful that I've always gotten a full hearing for my views and recommendations. And in my observation, Chairman Dunford always did as well. For President Obama valued not only my strategic advice and his other advisors, but also candid professional military advice. And he was always willing to listen to what we had to say, even if I knew it wasn't something he wanted to hear. President Obama also knows it's not only whether the decisions made are good that matters, but also whether they're implemented with excellence. Now, that's a management style that's actually rare among policymakers in Washington. Whether it was accelerating the counter-ISIL campaign, stopping the spread of Ebola, rebalancing to the Asia Pacific, President Obama's always insisted on getting the job done right to the end. He never hesitates to ask hard questions and keep asking until there's an answer. That's not only because he wanted his decision met and our objectives achieved, though both are important, but because he was committed to making sure that all our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines had what they needed to do their job. As you heard from Chairman Dunford, that kind of commitment means a lot to our troops. I've seen that up close as well. Many times I've visited service members on bases after the President has stopped by, or wounded warriors and their families at military hospitals after he's visited with them. And no matter how much time has passed, whether he's visited the week before, the month before, or the year before, they remember the genuineness of President Obama. They can feel, as only young troops can, the unending concern he has for our men and women in uniform and their families, and the boundless care with which he makes decisions that put them in harm's way. Over the course of 8 years, President Obama's level of dedication and mastery of his responsibilities has been remarkable. It's difficult for anyone to imagine the toll of never being able to unplug from their duties and their stakes for that long, all the while being a gracious and inspiring example, and all the while also helping to raise two daughters. It's impossible to imagine a man caring more, although possibly two sons. Mr. President, for this and more, I've been proud to serve as your Secretary of Defense. And from me and the entire Defense Department, thank you in full measure for your leadership, your support, and your devotion to our country and its defense. May you begin to feel the great weight shift from your shoulders. May you feel the warm wind of a nation's gratitude at your back. May God bless you and your family. And may God continue to bless the United States of America. Ladies and gentlemen, President of the United States, Barack Obama.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Please be seated. Well, good afternoon. Turns out these are easier when you're talking about somebody else. At moments like this, I think of all the times that I've stood before our men and women in uniform, commissioning our newest officers, presiding over promotions, presenting the Commander-in-Chief's trophy to the best football team in the military. I will let you argue over that one. I have never taken sides. Secretary Carter, I could not be more grateful for your gracious words, but more importantly for your outstanding leadership across, as you noted, more than three decades and nearly all of my presidency. You have always given me, Ash, your best strategic counsel. You've made sure that we were investing in innovation for the long term and a strong force for the future. As a physicist, Ash is also one of the few people who actually understands how our defense systems work. And I know that our troops and their families are immensely grateful for the compassion that you and Stephanie have shown them over the years. So to you and your family, on behalf of all of us, thank you for your outstanding service. General Dunford, we've relied on you as Commandant of the Marine Corps, as our commander in Afghanistan, and now as our nation's highest-ranking military officer. I thank you and General Selva and the entire Joint Chiefs for the unvarnished military advice that you've always provided to me, for your dedication, for your professionalism, for your integrity. Because of you, because of this team, our armed forces are more integrated and better prepared across domains, a truly joint force. Which is why, as a White Sox fan, I can overlook the fact that you love the Red Sox. Moreover, on a personal note, outside of your professional qualities. You are a good man, and I am grateful to have worked with you, and thank Ellen for allowing you to do this. To members of Congress, Vice President Biden, who along with Jill has known the love and the pride and the sacrifice of a military family, to Deputy Secretary Work, service secretaries, distinguished guests, dedicated civilians from across the Defense Department, my national security team, most of all, our men and women in uniform. I thank you for this honor and for the warmth and respect that you've always shown me, the support that you've shown Michelle and our daughters during these past 8 years. And so, although I recognize that the formalities require me listening to praise directed in large part to me, I want to turn the tables. I am still Commander-in-Chief, and so I get to do what I want to do, and I want to thank you. Of all the privileges of this office, and there are many, I will miss Air Force One, I will miss Marine One, but I can stand before you today and say that there has been no greater privilege and no greater honor than serving as the Commander-in-Chief of the greatest military in the history of the world. When I took office, I noted that presidents and those of you in uniform swear a similar oath to protect and defend this country and the Constitution that we cherish. And by stepping forward and volunteering, by raising your right hand and taking that oath, each of you made a solemn pledge. You committed yourself to a life of service and of sacrifice. And I, in turn, made a promise to you, which, to the best of my abilities, I've tried to uphold every single day since, that I would only send you into harm's way when it was absolutely necessary, with a strategy and well-defined goals, with the equipment and the support that you needed to get the job done, because that's what you rightfully expect, and that is what you rightfully deserve. I made that pledge at a time when less than 1% of Americans wear the uniform. Fewer Americans know someone who serves. And as a result, a lot of Americans don't see the sacrifices you make on our behalf. But as Commander-in-Chief, I do. I've seen it when I look in the eyes of young cadets, knowing that my decisions could very well send them into harm's way. I've seen it when I visited the field in Bagram, in Baghdad, far from your families, risking your lives so that we can live ours safely and in freedom. And so you've inspired me, and I've been humbled by you consistently. And I want every American to know what I know through year after year after year of continuous military operations, you have earned your place among the greatest generations. The list of accomplishments that Joe and Ash so generously mentioned, they're because of you. It's what I tell my staff. I'm the front man. But you're the ones doing the work. Because of you, our alliances are stronger, from Europe to the Asia Pacific. Because of you, we surged in Afghanistan, trained Afghan forces to defend their country, while bringing most of our troops home. Today, our forces serve there on a more limited mission, because we must never again allow Afghanistan to be used for a safe haven in attacks against our nation. It's because of you, particularly our remarkable special forces, that the core Al-Qaeda leadership that attacked us on 9/11 has been decimated. Countless terrorist leaders, including Osama bin Laden, are gone. From South Asia to Africa, we have forged partnerships to go after terrorists that threaten us. Because of you, we are leading the global coalition against ISIL. These terrorists have lost about half of their territory. They are losing their leaders. Towns and cities are being liberated, and I have no doubt this barbaric terrorist group will be destroyed because of you. You've shown that when it comes to fighting terrorism, we can be strong and we can be smart. Not by letting our forces get dragged into sectarian conflicts and civil wars, but with smart, sustainable, principled partnerships. That's how we brought most of our troops home, from nearly 180,000 troops in Iraq and Afghanistan down to 15,000 today. That's how, even as we've suffered terrible attacks here at home, from Boston to Orlando, no foreign terrorist organization has successfully planned and executed an attack on our homeland these past 8 years. Because of you, the world has seen the awesome reach of American armed forces. In some of the first few weeks of my job, when Somali pirates took Captain Phillips, later on when they kidnapped Jessica Buchanan, it was you that went in, and you that risked everything, and you that brought these Americans home to their families. The world has seen your compassion, the help you deliver in times of crisis, from an earthquake in Haiti to the tsunami in Japan. Think of Ebola and the countless lives this armed forces saved in West Africa. It was you that set up the architecture and set the example for the world's response. One woman in West Africa said, "We thanked God first, and then we thanked America second for caring about us." That's the difference you made. You continue to make in the lives of people around the world. As you know well, with service comes great sacrifice. And after 15 years of war, our wounded warriors bear the scars, both seen and unseen. In my visits to their bedsides and rehab centers, I have been in awe watching a wounded warrior grab his walker and pull himself up and through excruciating pain take a step and then another. Or hearing troops describe how they grappled with post-traumatic stress but summoned the strength to ask for help. As a military and as a nation, we have to keep supporting our resilient and incredibly strong wounded warriors as they learn to walk and run and heal. As they find new ways to keep serving our nation, they need to know that we still need your incredible talents. You've given so much to America, and I know you have more to give. And then you have not seen the depths of true love and true patriotism until you've been to Dover. When our troops receive our fallen heroes on their final journey home. Until you have grieved with our Gold Star families who've given a piece of their heart to our nation, a son or a daughter, a father or mother, a husband or wife. A brother or a sister. Everyone a patriot. Every single one of these American families deserves the everlasting gratitude and support of our entire nation. Today, after two major ground wars, our armed forces have drawn down, and that is natural and it is necessary. And after reckless budget cuts of sequester, we need to keep improving the readiness and the training and modernizing our forces. So let me take this opportunity, while I still have it, to appeal to our friends from Congress who are here. We cannot go back to sequestration. There's a responsible way forward. Investing in America's strengths, our national security, and our economic security. Investing in the reform and the equipment and the support that our troops need, including the pay and the benefits and the quality of life and the education and the jobs that our troops and our veterans and all of your families deserve. But make no mistake, even with the challenges of recent years, and there have been challenges, our allies and adversaries alike understand America's military remains by far the most capable fighting force on the face of the earth. Our Army, tested by years of combat, is the best trained and best equipped land force on the planet. Our Navy is the largest and most lethal in the world, on track to surpass 300 ships. Our Air Force, with its precision and reach, is unmatched. Our Marine Corps is the world's only truly expeditionary force. Our Coast Guard is the finest in the world. And we're also the best because this military has come to welcome the talents of more of our fellow Americans. Service members can now serve the country they love without hiding who they are or who they love. All combat positions in our military are now open to women. And Joe Biden and I know that women are at least as strong as men. We're stronger for it. It's one of the reasons that our military stands apart as the most respected institution in our nation by a mile. The American people look up to you and your devotion to duty and your integrity and your sense of honor and your commitment to each other. One of my proudest achievements is that I have been able to, I think, communicate through the constant partisan haze, along with so many others, how special this institution is. And the esteem in which our military has held steady and constant and high throughout my presidency. And I'm very grateful for that. Because you remind us that we are united as one team. At times of division, you've shown what it means to pull together. So my days as your Commander-in-Chief are coming to an end, and as I reflect on the challenges we have faced together and on those to come, I believe that one of the greatest tasks before our armed forces is to retain the high confidence that the American people rightly place in you. This is a responsibility not simply for those of you in uniform, but for those who lead you. It's the responsibility of our entire nation. And so we are called to remember core principles, that we must never hesitate to act when necessary to defend our nation, but we must also never rush into war, because sending you into harm's way should be a last and not first resort. It should be compelled by the needs of our security and not our politics. We need to remember that we must not give in to the false illusion of isolationism, because in this dangerous time, Oceans alone will not protect us, and the world still seeks and needs our leadership as the one indispensable nation. We have to remember that our military has to be prepared for the full spectrum of threats, conventional and unconventional, from 20th century style aggression to 21st century style cyber threats. And when we do go to war, we have to hold ourselves to high standards and do everything in our power to prevent the loss of innocent life, because that's what we stand for. That's what we should stand for. We have to remember that as we meet the threats of our times, we cannot sacrifice our values or our way of life. The rule of law and openness and tolerance that defines us as Americans, that is our greatest strength and makes us a beacon to the world. We cannot sacrifice the very freedoms that we're fighting for. And finally, in our democracy, the continued strength of our all-volunteer force also rests on something else. A strong bond of respect and trust between those in uniform and the citizens that you protect and defend. At a time when too few Americans truly understand the realities or sacrifices of military service, at a time when many political leaders have not served, if some in the military begin to feel as though somehow they are apart from the larger society they serve, those bonds can fray. As every generation learns anew, freedom is not free. And so while less than 1% of Americans may be fighting our wars, 100% of Americans can do their parts, at the very least, to support you and your families. Everybody can do something. Every business, every profession, every school, every community, every state, to reach out and to give back and to let you know that we care, to help make the lives of our troops and your families just a little bit easier. Everybody can do something. And that's why Michelle and Joe Biden have mobilized more Americans to honor and support you and your families through joining forces. And that's why, even after we leave the White House, Michelle and I intend to keep on looking for ways to help rally more of our fellow citizens to be there for you, just like you've always been there for us. So we can't say it enough, and we can't show it enough. Thank you for your patriotism. Thank you for your professionalism. Thank you for your character in representing the very best of the American spirit. Our nation endures. We live free under the red, white, and blue because of patriots like you. It has been a privilege of a lifetime to serve with you. I have learned much from you. I am a better man having worked with you. I'm confident that the United States and our armed forces will remain the greatest force for freedom and security that the world has ever known. God bless you and your families, and God bless the United States of America.
Ladies and gentlemen, the service songs of the Armed Forces of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's farewell tribute in honor of our Commander-in-Chief Barack Obama, the 44th President of the United States. Please remain at your seats and enjoy the United States Army Band until the departure of the official party from Comney Hall.